The views and opinions expressed in this program are not necessarily those of Union Broadcasting Inc., ESPN 1510, or its employees. The host is solely responsible for the on-air content. The following program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. Investing in ETFs involves risk, including the potential loss of principal. Any past performance figures discussed are not necessarily indicative of future results. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Now it's time for the ETF Store Show. The investment pros at the ETF Store discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Jason will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of the ETF Store Show, Nate Geraci.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the ETF Store Show. Nate Geraci along with Jason Lake in studio. Thanks for tuning in. We have a very nice show lined up for you today. In just a moment, we'll be joined by Christian Magoon, who's going to spotlight the wildly successful Pure Funds ISE Cybersecurity ETF, which, of course, holds the stocks of cybersecurity companies. Now, Christian serves as a consultant to this ETF. He helped launch and develop it. And Jason, this ETF debuted in November of last year. And in just 7 months, it already has over $1.2 billion invested in it. This has been one of the more successful ETF launches we've seen.
Unbelievable launch. That's in the ETF space, that's tremendous growth early on. Clearly, they have tapped into investor interest. You know, the timing is great. And you think about the headlines, you know, about the security breaches. And just recently, our own government, you know, records and security information and really pertinent data on millions of employees has been out there. So, you know, people want to know that the data that they give companies and our government is safe. And, you know, this is a direct response to this.
Yeah. So Christian will tell us all about the Pure Funds ISE Cybersecurity ETF. And we'll also talk about the cybersecurity industry as a whole. This is really a fascinating area right now. As you mentioned, Jason, we continue to see really an endless stream of headlines on businesses being hacked, Target, Sony, Anthem, who's the health insurer. And as you mentioned, just a couple of weeks ago, we even saw the federal government hack. So I think this will be an interesting discussion. And then later in the show, we will have a quick market update. We'll talk Greece, and we'll also be answering some listener questions today, including our listener question of the month. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can find us on Twitter, or you can email us at advice@etfstore.com. Let's start the show this morning with our ETF Spotlight.
It's time for the ETF Spotlight, where each week the ETF Store highlights one exchange-traded fund. There are over 1,700 ETFs available for you to choose from. The ETF Store sorts through them all, so you don't have to.
Again, the ETF we're spotlighting this week is the Pure Funds ISE Cybersecurity ETF. The ticker is HACK, so HACK, which is one of the better ETF tickers you're going to find. This has been one of the most successful ETF launches ever. As I mentioned, HACK was launched in November of last year, and just a few weeks ago, it crossed over the $1 billion mark in terms of investor dollars. And joining us via phone to spotlight this ETF is Christian Magoon. We've had Christian on the program before. He's a longtime ETF industry veteran. He's been involved in the launch of over 50 exchange-traded products. He's been featured on CNBC, Fox Business. He's been quoted in the Wall Street Journal. And as it relates to this ETF, he's serving as a consultant, and he helped develop and launch this ETF. Christian, as always, a pleasure to have you joining us today.
Hey, thanks for having me, Nate. A pleasure to be back on.
Well, Christian, let's start today by first just better understanding exactly what this ETF does. Obviously, it holds the stocks of companies involved with cybersecurity, but walk us through how these stocks are selected, how they're weighted, and how the ETF is rebalanced.
Sure. So HACK is an ETF that tracks an index of cybersecurity stocks. The index is called the ISE Cybersecurity Index. It's a rules-based investment methodology that selects a diverse group of companies that are actively involved in the cybersecurity industry around the world. So ISE, their analysts look at every company in the tech space that has some type of participation in the cybersecurity industry to start out as the beginning universe. They then whittle it down to companies that are really actively involved, that have material business interests in the cybersecurity space. And that really leaves the index with a universe of about 31 companies that actively participate in a variety of areas, mostly related to either the infrastructure surrounding cybersecurity or providing services in terms of cybersecurity. The index rebalances twice a year, and the weighting scheme is a modified equal weight. So most of the companies are equally weighted or close to equally weighted twice a year when the index rebalances.
And so just to be clear, this ETF will hold some international cybersecurity companies as well, correct?
That's great. Yeah, that's correct. So after the United States at about 70% of the portfolio's holdings, Israel comes in, or Israeli-based companies have about a 13% weight, and then you see some other companies from Europe and Asia as well.
If we look at some of the holdings in the ETF, Christian, I know one of the holdings is a company called FireEye, and I don't want to get too detailed here, but can you give us a better idea as to what a company like that does?
Yeah, they're a great example, Nate, of these kind of unique companies focused on cybersecurity. They're really doing two things. One is they produce software that's focused on automated threat forensics, so going in and trying to determine whether or not there's an active threat in the system. They also have a dynamic malware protection, kind of an automated system that's going out and gathering intelligence on the latest threats and trying to protect everything from networks to email systems to mobile devices. So that's one side of their business. The other side of their business, they have a group called Mandiant Consulting, and they do a lot of incident response as well as forensic investigation after attacks happen. So oftentimes you'll hear them called in to assess the impact or the status of an ongoing attack on either the U.S. government or one of the many corporations we've seen be hacked recently.
We're spotlighting the Pure Funds ISE Cybersecurity ETF, ticker HACK. We're joined by Christian Magoon, who serves as a consultant to this ETF. Christian, as we mentioned earlier, this has been one of the more successful ETF launches we've seen. In about 7 months, investors have poured over $1 billion into this ETF. Now, certainly performance has been a big driver. I believe HACK is up about 16% year-to-date. But clearly this ETF has struck a chord with investors. Why do you think that is?
I think the biggest reason is the prevalence of increased cyber attacks. Now, whether we look at the Sony attack that happened late last year, or even more recently, the U.S. government's Office of Personnel Management being hacked, hacks are increasing, and they're also becoming more expensive. And because of that, these cybersecurity companies are really benefiting. It's creating a robust business for them and really turning that industry from an industry that may be more discretionary spend into an essential spend. And investors are recognizing it and interested in investing in the shares of cybersecurity companies.
Well, let's talk more about this industry, because you're right. More and more we're hearing about cyber attacks on businesses and even the government. You mentioned a few weeks ago, we learned that the personal data of federal employees was hacked. And I actually came across an article from Business Insider where they said the U.S. Director of National Intelligence ranked cybercrime as the number one national security threat, ahead of terrorism, espionage, and weapons of mass destruction. That's a scary thought.
It really is. And you know what they believe now is that we're less likely to receive one massive cyber attack that knocks out infrastructure or information sharing in the U.S., but instead we're facing kind of a prolonged series of small, consistent, persistent attacks here in the U.S., and because of that, there's a lot of securing of information assets that needs to take place, and as we can tell from the headlines, there's a lot more work to be done, both in government and in the corporate side.
Well, that's right, because when we think about cyber attacks, we know that it's not just the government or the military that's at risk. We see attacks on businesses all the time. Of course, everyone remembers the credit card data stolen from Target, the hack on Sony. As a matter of fact, Christian, I pulled a clip from a recent 60 Minutes piece on the Sony hack, and I'm not sure if you caught this. This was from, I think, about a couple of months ago. But let me play this, and then I'd love to get your thoughts.
Computers now rule the world. They run everything. And we've given them this power over the years, really, I think, without seriously considering the potential consequences of doing it. And now we're beginning to realize that there are potential consequences and vulnerabilities in the systems that we had not anticipated when we were building these networks.
You know, this really stuck out to me because we've had this technological revolution. The internet and technology touches everything now. But because of that, I guess, does this also speak to the opportunity for cybersecurity companies because they now sort of have to play catch-up?
Yeah, I think it really does, Nate. There's a booming business in securing information assets, whether that's for individuals like us, corporations, or U.S. governments, or foreign governments, for that matter. So these companies in the cybersecurity space have just a great underlying, unfortunately, a great underlying business demand situation that's going on, and they're able to be more competitive in terms of pricing their services and their software, and there's just an insatiable demand for their services, which usually translates to the stock prices of cybersecurity companies.
It really is an amazing area. I saw another stat. I believe this was also from Business Insider, where research firm Gartner projects that the world will spend $80 billion on information security in 2015, with that figure rising to $101 billion in 2018. And they said that still won't be enough. So I guess your point, it's just difficult for me to see the need for cybersecurity diminishing anytime soon.
That's right. I mean, since 2009, studies show that cybersecurity incidents have grown 66% a year on a compounded annual growth rate. The costs of these attacks are also rising. The latest estimate is the average attack on a corporation that's reported is costing about $12.7 million, and that's up 96% over the last 5 years. So attacks are only increasing, unfortunately. The cost is getting greater. Because of that, it really is turning cybersecurity into a growth industry and something that has kind of a defensiveness built into it in terms of its underlying business demand.
Good morning, Christian. This is Jason Lank alongside Nate. Thanks for being with us. I wanted to ask you a question, take you back in time before Hack was launched. You're an industry veteran. Your phone rings. We'd like to be in a consultant. We've got an idea about cybersecurity. I guess my question is, how do ideas get hatched? You know, this is a specific niche in the industry. On our show, we talk about how ETFs have democratized investing, and whatever idea you have, whatever thesis for investing you want, there's an ETF that'll scratch that itch. Do investors call you and say, we want this ETF? Do ETF providers say, we've got an idea? How do these ideas percolate up and come to fruition?
Yeah, that's a great question, Jason. I've been involved with a lot of first-to-market ETFs, first solar ETF, first brick ETF in the U.S., and it's really a combination of how these come about. At times, there's institutional investors, professional investors who are looking for kind of access, convenient access to an idea or investment strategy or a theme, and they kind of begin the ETF idea process. Other times, index providers are doing research into a certain area, and they see a theme or a trend or a subsector that looks promising, and they just keep monitoring it. Many times these emerging areas take a while to grow in terms of the amount of companies, their market cap, and their trading volume to be put into an ETF. So this specific idea came from the index provider ISE, who has a cloud computing index out. They created about 4 years ago that an ETF tracks. And while they were doing the research there, began to monitor the cybersecurity industry. And only in the last year or so has there been enough companies, market cap, trading volume to begin to think about creating an investable index. That then happened, and thus we were here with the cybersecurity ETF hack.
Another question, and I know you're a consultant to the ETF, not necessarily the companies held, but who's doing the hacking here? You know, maybe 20 years ago, it was a teenager in their mom's basement, you know, fooling around. But today, it strikes me as state-sponsored or organized crime. I mean, these are big events with big dollars associated with them and very, very sophisticated. Who's doing this?
Well, it's a variety of participants. Definitely, there are organized hacking cells. Some of them are, definitely sponsored by states. There's a few states, specifically in Asia, that have been mentioned. It's, you know, it's interesting you kind of bring that topic up this weekend. Hillary Clinton, in a statement on Saturday, brought up China specifically. She was quoted as saying that China's trying to hack into everything that doesn't move in America. So she's introducing kind of cybersecurity into the presidential race, which actually could be a bullish move for cybersecurity stocks. So we're seeing state-sponsored hacking. We're seeing organized crime. You know, there's just the fruits are so robust. Again, we're talking about an average attack causing over $10 million of damage. So I think, unfortunately, as we have more devices, more networks, more mobility with digital assets, we're going to see increased amount of attacks from all types of parties.
We're spotlighting the Pure Funds ISE Cybersecurity ETF, ticker HACK. We're joined by Christian Magoon, who serves as a consultant to this ETF. Christian, we have just a couple of minutes left here. I guess given everything that we've talked about here today, where does an ETF like this fit in an investor's portfolio?
We're seeing really two areas where HACK is being applied into a portfolio. One is a long-term growth play that is relatively complementary to existing holdings. The one unique part about the cybersecurity ETF is there's very little overlap in the companies it owns compared to kind of broad-based technology ETFs or funds. So if you look at, for example, a SPDR technology ETF or a NASDAQ 100 ETF, you see very little overlap between the two funds. So, again, a growth play that is additive to a portfolio. The other area we're seeing HACK being used for is as a way to participate in cybersecurity during event-driven headline-type news, whether it's an attack or new contract or spending figures that are released on cybersecurity. These stocks are fairly volatile. So when you do see an attack happen, you do see increased volume in the stocks and in the ETF. And some people are just saying, you know what, I'm not going to take company-specific risk and try to pick one or two cybersecurity companies. Instead, I'm going to own a basket of 31 and buy the ETF and try to take advantage of kind of these event-driven moves in the cybersecurity market.
Christian, before we let you go, I understand you and everyone associated with this ETF are actually ringing the bell at the New York Stock Exchange this week. Is that on Thursday?
That's right, Nate. We have the privilege of opening the bell at the NYSE this Thursday. So we look forward to that. And, you know, it's a celebration of the HACK being able to cross over $1 billion in a very short time period. So we're thankful and we're very optimistic about the ETF's future.
Well, congratulations on all the success with this ETF. And as always, we appreciate you joining us on the program.
Thanks. Great to be back on.
That was Christian Magoon. Again, he serves as a consultant to the Pure Funds ISE Cybersecurity ETF. And you can learn more about this ETF by visiting pureetfs.com. That's pureetfs.com. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll have a quick market update. And later, we'll be answering your questions on ETFs, including our listener question of the month. This is the ETF Store Show on ESPN 1510.
Do you have any questions about your retirement strategy? Need help crafting a plan? Call an ETF Store investment advisor today at 877-365-ETFS. That's 877-365-3837. Or visit ETFstore.com.
Want a more beautiful, livable home? Talk to Schlegel Design Remodel. No one offers more ways to add value to your home while saving you money.
I'm Jake Schlegel. We have services for every need, like our popular one-week bath and express custom kitchen remodels, completed in a lot less time for a lot less money. We also offer professional handyman services for chores around your home.
Whatever your needs, call Schlegel Design Remodel, 816-361-9669, or go to remodelagain.com today.
Hi, this is David Van Oy of the Van Oy Group at Reese & Nichols Realtors. Thanks for listening to my friends at the ETF Store. When making decisions about buying or selling a home, you need first someone who is knowledgeable and someone you can trust. With 9 years of experience and over $40 million in residential sales, I would love an opportunity to apply for that job. If you would like more information on a specific home or a property evaluation in Missouri, call 536-SOLD. In Kansas, call 259-HOME. Or go to our website, thevanoygroup.com.
Tired of running around town trying to find the best products for your business? Regal Distributing can help. With over 9,000 stock products in categories like food service packaging, professional facilities, office supplies, and sustainable janitorial solutions, you'll be sure to find what you need at Regal. Visit us on the web at GetRegal.com or call locally at 913-894-8787. And don't forget to check out Regal's state-of-the-art showroom and training center located off 435 and K-10 Highway. Go with the local partner you can trust. Go with Regal, distributing service and solutions since 1955.
There's a revolution occurring in the investment world. Exchange-traded funds, which have been called the next-generation mutual funds, can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and increase your investment options. This is Nate Geraci with the ETF Store, an investment advisor located right here in Kansas City. Call us toll-free at 877-365-3837 or visit us online at etfstore.com. And don't forget to tune in to the ETF Store Show every Tuesday at 9 a.m. right here on ESPN 1510.
There's never a bad time to see your dentist. So if you haven't been for a while or if one of your teeth is actually starting to hurt, it's always easier to fix it before it gets worse. We aren't anti-dentites like the Seinfeld episode. So give Dr. Kevin or Matt Cummings a call at 816-246-1003 or check us out on our website, www.cummingsdentistry.com. Remember, floss the ones you want to keep and mention this ad and get a 10% discount on your first visit.
Business disputes are rarely just about money. Oftentimes, they involve a breach of trust or a fundamental disagreement about the terms or operation of the business. The law firm of Graves Garrett offers comprehensive and creative solutions to these types of complex legal problems. Graves Garrett represents businesses and individuals nationwide in commercial litigation, white-collar criminal defense litigation, and compliance and internal investigations. If you're involved in a critical legal dispute, let Graves Garrett be your voice. Visit GravesGarrett.com or call 816-256-3181.
The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely on advertisements.
Welcome back to the ETF Store Show. Nate Geraci and Jason Lank in studio this morning. Now it's time for our weekly market update.
And now it's time for this week's market update. Tune in every week as the ETF Store brings you the information you need to know on the financial markets.
Since we ran short on time last week and didn't have an opportunity to get to this, what I'd like to do is walk through the returns from some different investments from the first half of 2015. So let me quickly do that, and then Jason, perhaps you can provide a little color here. The S&P 500 returned a little over 1% in the first half of the year. Small cap U.S. stocks returned close to 5%. Developed international stocks were up nearly 7%. Emerging market stocks were up over 3%. Intermediate term treasuries were flat. Gold was down 1%. Broad-based commodities were down 3%. And finally, real estate was down over 6% if you look at something like the Vanguard REIT ETF. Obviously, what clearly sticks out is the performance of developed international stocks if you look at places like Europe and Japan. But Jason, given what we've seen from Greece recently, Europe in particular will certainly bear watching.
It will. You know, as we pass the midway mark for the year, a couple of things stand out. You know, Greece is the story that's never ending. And, you know, I think we all know the end game here. They have a lot of debt that will probably never be repaid. And on Sunday, of course, was the referendum that the people, you know, voted and they said no to further austerity. What's interesting is they didn't vote no to leaving the Europe or vote to form their own currency. They said enough's enough. We can't stay in this. And, you know, the drama and the games go on. I think at this point it's less about the dollars than it is the politics and the various people and entities and egos surrounding membership in the euro. You gave some interesting return figures for the U.S. markets. When most people turn on the TV at night and, you know, check their statements or just, you know, what did the market do today, they tend to look at the S&P, perhaps the Dow, but the S&P is that broad index of U.S. stocks. And year to date, it's about flat. you know, slightly to positive on any given day. It's up or down. And, you know, I've taken some questions lately about, you know, what's the market doing? Where are we going? Why haven't we made any money? And I would say to you that while things are generally positive, there is a bit of a hangover for folks in terms of the last 5 or 6 years. We've seen tremendous growth since the bottom of 2009. And so what I would tell you is if, you know, if you've had 6 to 8 months of flat, you know, very little return in your portfolio, that's okay. Sometimes the market, you know, takes 2 steps forward, 1 step back, 2 steps forward, 1 step back. Or, you know, it pauses to catch its breath and perhaps let the economy catch up with the growth we've seen. So there are times when we are paid to be patient. And I think we're in one of those periods of time.
Yeah, that being said, I think the first half of 2015, and we talked about this a few weeks ago on the show, also highlights the benefits of diversification. Because if you do look at developed international stocks, which have returned nearly 7%, and you look at small cap U.S. stocks, which were up close to 5%, emerging market stocks up over 3%. Owning some of these assets in your portfolio would have given a boost to returns.
And it hasn't worked for several years. And I think that's an important lesson for investors that, you know, foundational concepts of your portfolio shouldn't be judged on a quarter over quarter or year over year basis. You know, since stock market investing began, diversification, owning different things, has worked over business cycles, not necessarily every day or week or month, or even there are multi-year periods where seemingly, hey, things are different now. Well, no, they're not. It's just that things do cycle, and the benefits of owning lots of different things really is key, especially when, you know, markets, you know, are, you know, choppy as they are today.
Now, of course, the other thing, as we enter the back half of the year, we know investors will continue to watch the Fed. Prior to these issues with Greece, it seemed like we were on track for a September rate hike. But it looks like we'll have to now wait and see. A couple of weeks ago at her press conference, Fed Chair Janet Yellen indicated that as long as economic progress continues, we would be on track for a rate increase. But I pulled a clip from this press conference where she really emphasized the labor markets. She said the labor markets have improved, but the Fed still wants to see more progress before raising rates, which is what they expect, but they want to make sure that's what they actually see. Take a listen to this.
We agreed that labor market slack has diminished to some extent in the intermeeting period, and clearly over a longer span of time over the last several years, obviously we've made considerable progress in moving toward our goal of maximum employment. So in spite of the fact that there is some progress on that front, the committee wants to see some further progress before feeling that it will be appropriate to raise rates.
So she said the labor markets had improved, but she also reiterated that the Fed wants to see further progress before raising rates. Jason, this will obviously be the other major story the second half of the year, and it will be interesting to see what, if any, impact the situation over in Greece has on what the Fed ultimately decides to do.
It will. Certainly the Federal Reserve takes a look at world events when it decides what it will do. But yeah, for the rest of this year, it's going to be our rates rised, when, how many times, how much. She used the term maximum employment. And you know, that's, I think, intentionally vague. What does maximum mean? Is that everybody's working in the country? Is that a percentage? Is that a rate? One of the things that the Fed can't do is they can't tell companies what kind of job to create. You know, it's one thing to create 5 or 6 new part-time jobs at minimum wage. It's another to create full-time great positions with benefits. And the Federal Reserve, as much as they can do, can't tell businesses how to operate. And so, you know, Janet Yellen and the Federal Reserve, they're going to look at the composition of the jobs being created, how many people are at work. And one of the key factors when looking at the employment marketplace is the participation rate. And what's troubling to many is that the percentage of Americans who are looking for work is one of the lowest in decades. So in a strange way, if you have stopped looking for work for whatever reason, you've given up or something else, you're no longer counted as unemployed, which is a little counterintuitive. So we'll have to see how the Federal Reserve looks at the number of people working, the number of people not working, either by choice or involuntarily, and how that impacts their decision-making process.
Yeah, barring some surprise in the second half of the year, the two stories are going to be Europe and the Fed.
Yep.
So it'll be interesting to watch both of those play out. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll answer some listener questions, including our listener question of the month. This is the ETF Store Show on ESPN 1510.
Do you have any questions about your retirement strategy? Need help crafting a plan? Call an ETF Store investment advisor today at 877-365-ETFS. That's 877-365-3837. Or visit ETFstore.com.
Are life stresses beginning to take their toll? Take time to maintain your health by seeing one of our exceptional therapists at My Massage Bliss. At My Massage Bliss, we provide a level of service well above the industry standard by providing the best therapist, staff, and value for your time and money. Don't take our word for it. Our ratings and reviews speak for themselves. Come visit us in Overland Park on the corner of 143rd and Metcalf, online at mymassagebliss.net, or give us a call at 913-956-5100. We look forward to serving you.
If you, a family member, or maybe someone you know have been the victim of someone else's negligence, whether due to a motor vehicle collision, an accident at work, a slip and fall, or a product defect, you may be entitled to compensation under the law. The law firm of Van Zanten & Onick is exclusively dedicated to representing victims of negligence in Kansas and Missouri. Please call 816-479-0404 today for a free consultation. Again, 816-479-0404. The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely upon advertisements.
Will you profit from rising food prices?
Bulk Food International.
Do you want a tangible asset besides gold or silver?
Bulk Food International.
Would you like to own an investment that will be valuable 10, 20, 30 years from now?
Bulk Food International.
With Bulk Food International, you can own a variety of food products that will be viable and valuable for years to come. Bulk Food International will store your products for you or deliver to your location. Best of all, you can use your IRA or 401k funds to make your purchase. Bulk Food International, 816-888-8290. Investing in your future.
Typical estate planning is transactional, focused solely on money, offering cookie-cutter documents, resulting in plans that do not address what is truly important to you and your loved ones. Bridge Builder's unique planning process focuses on the three dimensions of family wealth: financial, what you own; human, who you are; and intellectual, what you know. Bridge Builder, plans for life, architects at protecting and perpetuating family wealth for generations. Please contact Bridge Builder for a free consultation at 913-956-3984.
Looking for a great excuse to enjoy a Friday afternoon on the golf course? Join us for the annual Bushnell Charity Golf Tournament, benefiting United Way of Greater Kansas City. Bushnell is a leader in the golf and outdoor industry, so rest assured that our golf tournament is done to perfection. Join us on September 18th at St. Andrews Golf Course, located in Overland Park. To learn more or register, visit bushnellgolf.com/tournament.
It's a fact that most any day can be a special day for someone. A birthday, an engagement, an anniversary, a promotion, or an I love you day. It's also a fact that Lichtenberg's Fine Jewelry offers hundreds of ways to say love or thanks or congrats or I'm so happy you're in my life. So when you want to make your special day extra special, think Lichtenberg's Fine Jewelry, 131st and State Line, 816-941-2221.
Love your job? We do at Accent. We're now hiring customer engagement specialists. Great team members, caring leaders, career advancement opportunities, helping our community. Those are just a few reasons why our employees love working at Accent and why you will too. We're seeking energetic, motivated individuals with a customer-focused attitude to answer inbound customer service calls. You'll receive paid training, good benefits, and a fun environment with room to grow. Apply at accentonline.com/careers.
Looking to ship freight but not sure how? Choose AOK Freight to be your single source for all your shipping needs, and we'll take care of all the work for you. We offer the balance of budget-friendly prices, seasoned account managers, and trusted trucking options with leading technology. With more than 20 years of experience in the freight shipping industry and having moved over $1 billion in freight, we know the importance of providing competitive rates and dependable services for truckload, LTL, and intermodal freight services for all industries. If you are a company looking to save on your shipping expense without without giving up dependability, let us be your personal shipping assistant. Call us now at 816-301-6226 or find us on the web at www.aokfreight.com. Do stains in your carpet keep coming back and now you're stressing over the high cost to replace it? Then you need to call Zero Res. Their carpet cleaning process does not use soaps or toxic chemicals, which all leave behind residues that attract more dirt immediately. This zero residue technology will not only have your carpets looking great, it also extends the life of your carpet. Check them out online at ZeroResKC.com or call 816-425-3655 and schedule your cleaning today.
There's a revolution occurring in the investment world. Exchange-traded funds, which have been called the next-generation mutual funds, can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and increase your investment options. This is Nate Geraci with the ETF Store, an investment advisor located right here in Kansas City. Call us toll-free at 877-365-3837 or visit us online at etfstore.com. And don't forget to tune in to the ETF Store Show every Tuesday at 9 a.m. right here on ESPN 1510.
For those of you who haven't heard, the oldest building in Kansas City has the newest rooftop deck. Kelly's Westport Inn's rooftop deck has a full-service bar, TVs, bathrooms, lots of fans, and an awesome view of Westport. Kelly's has a weekday happy hour Monday through Friday from 3 to 7. They also have live music every Friday and Saturday night. Come enjoy tunes from bands like Lost Wax, Flanagan's Right Hook, and Michael Beer's Band. Every city has a place where the elite gather for witty conversation over trendy cocktails. In Kansas City, that place is definitely not Kelly's. For more information, go to kellyswestportinn.com.
Has it been a while since you or your financial advisor reviewed the investments in your portfolio? With today's ever-changing global economy, it's become more critical than ever to make sure your portfolio is on track. Whether you're managing your own investments or using an advisor, it never hurts to get a second opinion. At the ETF Store, we provide free consultations on your portfolio. We'll highlight the strengths and weaknesses and tell you exactly what you're paying for your investments. This is absolutely free. There's no obligation. Just give us a call at 816-363-3837 or click on the free consultation button at etfstore.com.
Welcome back to the ETF Store Show. Nate Geraci and Jason Lank in studio this morning. We're going to spend the remainder of the show today answering some listener questions. And as a reminder, if you have a question for us, you can do one of three things. You can either go to etfstore.com and click on the Ask the Host button. You can email us at advice@etfstore.com, or you can send us questions through Twitter. Now, there is actually a fourth option, which is that you can always just ask us a question in person. And Jason, that was the case with the first question we have today. I was at my two daughters' swim meet last week, which, by the way, my 8-year-old daughter, she's doing extremely well. We might have a little Michael Phelps on our hands here. But I met a very nice individual. His name was Mark. And Mark asked me what I did for a living. And I told him about the ETF Store. And Mark was clearly familiar with us and with ETFs. And we had a nice conversation. But then he asked me the following. He said, if most ETFs just track indexes, why do I need an advisor like you to manage a portfolio for me? Can't I just buy these ETFs on my own? And Mark was very friendly with this question, but it was also clear that he felt like if we're not selecting active managers or picking individual stocks, he wasn't quite sure what value we were adding. And I thought this was an important question to answer on the air. I told Mark I would like to do so, and he agreed. But Jason, there's a lot to this question, so I'm not quite sure where we should begin, but I guess we might start by first explaining what it is we do.
That's right. And we want to peel back the layers to his question, because there's a lot of meat on the bone here. He probably has a lot of questions, and he's bundled them up into one. It's not necessarily about an advisor or the type of investments that a particular advisor uses. You know, I think what he's really asking is, what's the value of an advisor? You know, is it worth paying someone? What do you do? And the reason I love this question, every investor out there, whether you manage your own portfolio or you've decided to have a professional assist you, ask this question. It's foundational, and it starts off with the fact that I think sometimes people make the mistake of thinking that we just do what they already do, but we charge for it, and that's not the case. There is a lot of work to be done, and really, it's a question of who's going to do it And are you capable of doing it? Do you want to do it? Or is your time better spent somewhere else? So let's talk about what we actually do, and rather than, you know, an ETF or an individual stock or a mutual fund. What's an advisor do? Let's start with defining your risk profile. Every investor has to decide how much risk they're willing to take. And it's common for people to be very confident in this area when times are good. You remember the great boxer Mike Tyson said, everybody has a plan until they get punched in the mouth. Well, it's important to remember that depending on your age and what you're willing, the volatility you're willing to undertake, how you will respond. And so you really want to make sure that the portfolio, the risk level, the volatility matches your investment attitude.
Well, and it's interesting because there are academic studies out there that show people tend to think they are much more risk tolerant,
you bet,
than what they actually are.
We do see that. And especially I get a little fearful, you know, we've had 5-6 years of up markets, and, you know, unless you were in a cave, your portfolio is worth more now than it has been for many years. And we haven't had a significant pullback for years. And so it's very common for people to feel confident, or, you know, this is, you know, extrapolate the last 6 years into the next 6 years. The next thing that I think in terms of what the workload that everybody has to undertake is, I've got to get my allocation right. How do you translate your risk profile, your objectives and your dreams, your desires into a tangible portfolio? And this is where there's a lot of work to be done. For all the benefits exchange-traded funds have given investors, the low costs, the efficiencies, the tax efficiencies, intraday trading, we can go on and on. What they've created is an information overload. There is an ETF for everybody and everything and every sliver, every country, small, medium, large, growth, domestic, on and on and on. So how do you translate my desires and goals as an investor into the tangible portfolio? And frankly, that's a question in and of itself. How do you decide what to own? There's a lot to that. So that's part of what an advisor, a good advisor, will help you do, is translate those. Then we've got the tax implications, of course. For many investors, the bulk of their savings are in IRAs or Roth IRAs, where it's not that critical in terms of trading. But for investors who have individual accounts, trust accounts, inheritances, non-qualified accounts, as we say, there are absolutely tax implications to the moves that you make. You know, what kind of ETFs do you own? How often do you trade them? You know, we've got short-term gain, long-term gain, and dividends and income. And so we want to take that into consideration as we formulate a plan and rebalance throughout time. You know, Nate, this is something, a fourth area is the due diligence. Once you've decided what kind of investor you are, you've translated that into a tangible portfolio of ETFs, of at least concepts and sectors that you want to own, boy, you've got to do some work. You've got to roll up your sleeves and do the research. And you know, we do a lot of that here, Nate, and that is a really time-sensitive issue.
Yeah, you know, I think that's a wonderful outline that you just walked through in terms of what an advisor does. And you were probably going to get to this as well. But, you know, one of the things I told Mark was that the value of an advisor is not picking the hot mutual fund managers or stocks or even index funds. A good advisor is really a behavioral coach, because Mark is right in that he could go and buy index-based ETFs on his own. And maybe Mark could even put together a pretty good allocation in his portfolio. But the question is, when the market goes down 10% or 15% or 30%, will Mark stick to his plan? In my opinion, the biggest value of an advisor is you have an independent, unemotional third party in the room who can prevent you from making emotional decisions. And emotional decisions are where many investors end up hurting their returns.
Oh, you know, over the last 25 years of doing this, I've seen that time and time again. I'll give you an anecdote. Just a few weeks ago, I had a phone call from a client, and he had gotten a hot stock tip from a family member. And, you know, this guy had made some money in it and was obviously, you know, crowing about his investment prowess, which is great. But my client was thinking about putting half his portfolio in one stock. And we had a long discussion about risks associated with that and what kind of investor he truly is and what it means to have a significant portion of your wealth in one issue. And we can talk a lot about that. But the point was, in many, many areas, you want a second opinion. Corporations spend billions of dollars a year making sure they get every single decision right. And when it comes to something as important as your net worth, it in many cases, it pays to have just somebody else, unemotional, look at it. And you talk about behavioral coach. How do investors hurt themselves? Dalbar, an institution that really tracks investor behavior and its implications, had a really interesting study, and it showed that the investor, actual investor performance was much, much less than the performance of the mutual funds they were invested in. And it, how can that be? If I'm investing in a fund, don't I get the fund performance? Well, you might, but you need to own it the entire time. And what they showed was that if you had just bought, you know, XYZ fund or investment and held it for a 10 or 20 period of time, you do great. But as a whole, investors get anywhere from 1% to 3% less than the underlying investments. And there's only one reason for that, and that's the decisions they're making.
That's what's called the behavior gap.
That's exactly it. You know, I'll end with this. If you've ever been in the hospital, one of the things that one of the procedures is that they really don't let physicians operate on family members. And you know, there's, even if you're the best physician in the world, if your spouse is sick or your kids are sick, and that's an area of your expertise, you're still not going to be the person with the knife in your hand in the operating room. And there's a reason for that. It's the emotions involved. It is far, far, far different situation to have a stranger in front of you and offer impartial advice or do the job that you do. It's a whole different thing to have a family member in front of you, or in our case, what we're discussing, Nate, you know, your own money. And so it just adds an element, and it leads to these situations like the Dalbar outcome.
Well, we need to move on to our next question here, but Vanguard put together some wonderful research where they actually tried to quantify the value of an advisor. And what they found was that a good advisor can add about 3% a year to investor returns over time. And this 3% came from several places. Half was from the behavioral coaching we were just talking about. And then the other 1.5% came from a combination of things like using cost-effective investments, performing regular rebalancing, and making sure investments are located in the right accounts, taxable versus non-taxable. So a good advisor can certainly add value if they're doing all the things they should be doing. And it's up to the individual, in this case, Mark, as to whether he wants to do these things or hire someone to do them on his behalf. And again, taking into account the behavioral side of the equation. Okay, I'm not sure how many questions we'll be able to get to today, but I do want to make sure we get to our listener question of the month. So let's do that now.
You've got mail.
You have questions, we have answers. It's time for the ETF Store Show's Listener Question of the Month. Have a question on ETFs or investing? Submit your question by going to ETFstore.com and clicking on the Ask the Host button. If the ETF Store pros select your question, you'll receive a $50 gift card.
Our Listener Question of the Month comes from Matt Ostrega of Overland Park, Kansas. And he asks the following: with looming interest rate hikes in the second half of the year in the U.S., what investment areas should I be transitioning to? And he asked about commodities, emerging markets, treasuries. He also expressed concern that rising rates might lead to a pullback in U.S. stocks. Jason, again, just like our last question, this is a question with a lot of meat on the bone. And we selected this question as our listener question of the month because this is a concern on the minds of many investors right now. And let me first start by saying it's still not a certainty that the Fed is going to raise interest rates this year. Well, at the moment, that does look to be the case, and they may even hike rates in September. The possibility does exist that they hold off until 2016. Now, I'm also always hesitant to offer investment guidance based on speculation. In other words, whether it's the prospect of rising rates or Greece leaving the EU or Russia invading Ukraine or whatever, I think investors should be very careful about trying to, quote unquote, position their portfolios for these events or try to predict or react to these events. And Jason, I don't mean to be, you know, I don't mean that as a negative. This just goes back to what we were talking about with the previous question. You need to have the right investment allocation for your situation. Start there before you do anything else?
It's a great question because, you know, we're at the end of a 30-year bull market for bonds. You know, interest rates, generally speaking, have gone down since Ronald Reagan was president. That's a long time. And so for many investors, they haven't been in a rising interest rate investment environment. You know, unless you're, you know, long in the tooth, 60, 70, 80 years old, you just haven't seen it. You're right in that it's hard to get the timing right. I think everybody knows interest rates are going up. What we don't know is when. You know, over a year ago, in fact, in early 2014, the pundits were talking about rising interest rates. Well, they went down. So if the experts can't tell you when or how much, you know, it's difficult to start adjusting your portfolio based on that. There's always going to be something in the news that causes you to think, should I be repositioning? You're right. It starts with the allocation. But really three steps here. Do I make a change? First off, yes or no? If so, what kind of change? And then thirdly, the magnitude of the change if you decide to make one. Do you turn your portfolio based on potentially rising interest rates upside down on its ear? Or do you tinker around the edges, perhaps make some strategic, small tactical moves to try to address that? It's very much dependent upon your time frame. Now, we don't know how old the person who asked the question is. If you're 30 years old, I would probably say there's not too much that you need to do. You know, you have multiple years, multiple business cycles to invest in. Now, if you're 65 or 70 and a large part of your portfolio is in fixed income or bonds that are interest rate sensitive, yeah, I think this is an area you want to take a look at. You certainly don't want to stand in front of a freight train if interest rates do rise and you're in a 100% fixed income portfolio. I would offer three concrete suggestions, and Nate, maybe you can add some color here. The first one would be the bullet share concept. One of the neat things about exchange-traded funds, they've packaged an idea where you can get a fixed-ending ETF. For example, the 2018 bullet share. What that does is that the provider packages, you know, numerous bonds that all mature in 2018 into one trading security. So for investors who've never owned an individual bond, one of the advantages of owning a bond outright rather than through a fund approach is that I know what I paid for, and as long as they don't go bankrupt, I get my interest and payments. Now, the value may fluctuate between now and maturity, but I know when I get my money back. Well, we can now do that on a diversified basis within an ETF product called a bullet share. So this is really an area that's gathered a lot of interest. And there are different maturities each year, 2014, 15, 16, 17, 18. So that's certainly an area that investors want to check out. Another area that you might want to pursue in a rising interest rate environment is a floating rate ETF. So that's an ETF that, as interest rates, if they do increase, you'll participate in the higher interest rate. So you're not locked in, for example, like a CD. The performance of the instrument will depend on what interest rates do. So if you have that position that interest rates are going up, might be a product for you. The third area, more not necessarily a product, but a strategy, and that's called shortening your duration. Duration is a fancy way of saying, how sensitive are my instruments or my securities to rising interest rates? We all know that bonds and interest rates have an inverse relationship. And this is really the thrust of the question. If interest rates go up, do the value of my bonds go down? And the answer is yes, potentially they could. So how sensitive are your instruments to rising interest rates? Well, when we say shorten the duration, we're saying let's make them less sensitive. Rising in interest rates perhaps won't be as impactful on my portfolio. So those are three specific strategies that investors might want to look at.
Now, I think those are some good suggestions because the fact is interest rates are still close to historical lows. And we know that at some point rates are going to rise. So Jason, as you mentioned, as an investor, you don't want to stand in front of a freight train. So, you know, there are some things you can do to better balance your risk versus reward. Again, for younger investors, I don't think you should lose much sleep over the potential for rising rates. You have a long time horizon. And ultimately, if you have exposure to bonds through bond mutual funds or bond ETFs, you'll actually benefit from rising rates over the long term. But for individuals closer to retirement or in retirement, where you have a fairly healthy allocation of bonds, I think those are some good suggestions. Quickly here, as it relates to the stock market, which was part of Matt's question, it's interesting. If you look historically, the impact of interest rate hikes on stocks isn't as scary as you might think. Goldman Sachs produced a great chart. We posted this at etfstore.com a few months ago, where it shows that for the three most recent Fed rate increases, in other words, the last three Fed tightening cycles, The S&P 500 averaged a 17% gain in the 12 months leading up to the increase and a 6% gain in the 12 months after an increase. Now, obviously, returns were much lower after the rate increase, but it's not like they fell off a cliff.
Right. The correlation between stock market performance and rising or falling interest rates isn't as robust as many people think. It's interesting in that I'm actually concerned about a lot of things, but a 50 basis point, 25 basis point, some small incremental change in interest rates isn't necessarily one of them.
Yeah. In any event, a great question for Matt, and Matt will be receiving a $50 gift card to Bella Napoli, which if you're in the Kansas City area, this is a great place to go for coffee, lunch, or dinner. It's Italian cuisine. They do a fantastic job there. They have outdoor seating. It's really a great place to go. So congratulations to Matt, and thank you to Bella Napoli. That's all the time we have for today's show. I want to thank Christian Magoon for joining us to spotlight the PureFund Cybersecurity ETF. Hope you enjoyed our conversation with Christian. Podcasts of the ETF Store Show are available at etfstore.com and also Apple iTunes. Check us out on social media. We're on Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn. You can stay up to date on all the latest from both the ETF Store and the ETF Store Show. Thanks again for joining us this morning, and be sure to tune in next Tuesday. We have yet another tremendous guest lined up for you. Ben Johnson, Director of Global ETF Research at Morningstar, will join us to talk active versus passive management. We're going to look at this through a clear lens and talk about the pros and cons of each. Until then, have a great week, everyone.